Hello, good morning. My name is Kadeen Smith. I'm the project coordinator for the Caribbean Future Forum. Welcome to the sixth episode of our new Carib Web Dialogue series, the SDGs and You. This, of course, is the sixth in a new series of Caribbean Future Forum webinars, which aim at raising awareness of the Sustainable Development Goals, commonly referred to as the SDGs, their relevance to the Caribbean, and how we as a region can achieve these goals. In today's webinar, we are focusing on gender and sexual orientation, access to justice. This topic addresses SDG 5, which is to achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls, as well as SDG 10, which is to reduce inequalities. Joining us today is Judge Helen Whitener, and a warm welcome to you, Helen.
Good morning, thank you.
Judge Whitener was born and raised in the beautiful Caribbean island nation of Trinidad and Tobago. Educated in the British system, Judge Whitener arrived in the United States at the age of 16 to attend college, where she earned a bachelor's degree in business administration and international marketing. She then entered law school in 1995 at Seattle University School of Law, where she obtained her JD degree in 1998. On January 13, 2015, Judge Whitener was appointed by Washington State Governor Jay Inslee to the Pierce County Superior Court, which is the highest trial court in the state of Washington. Prior to her appointment, Judge Whitener was a former Washington State Board of Industrial Insurance Appeals Judge and a former pro tem. Judge in Pierce County District Court and the City of Tacoma Municipal Court. Judge Whitener speaks quite often on human rights, access to justice, and the rights and responsibility of the judiciary, in ensuring the rights of all that appear before them to basic dignity and respect in judicial proceedings. She is very active locally, nationally, and internationally in various community service activities. In June 2015, Judge Whitener, at the request of the U.S. Embassy, visited her home country of Trinidad and Tobago to speak on human rights. Judge Whitener is a member of the International Association of Women Judges, the American Judge Association, the National Association of Women Judges, the Washington Court Superior Court Judges Association, the Washington State Bar Association, and other civic-minded organizations. Just before handing over to Judge Whitener, I would like to remind you to stay up to date with our activities through our website at CaribbeanFutureForum.com, our Facebook page, Caribbean Future Forum, and of course, you can follow us on Twitter at @forum_Caribbean. Throughout this webinar, please do feel free to submit your questions in the Q&A box that you will see below the screen. And now, without further ado, I'd like to hand over to Judge Whitener.
Good morning. I want to thank the Caribbean Future Forum, the United Nations, and the other partners of the Caribbean Future Forum for the invitation to speak on gender and sexual orientation, the challenge to social sustainability as it pertains to access to justice. I also thank all of you who have taken the time to attend this webinar. I recently attended a conference of women judges from 81 countries, where the theme of the conference was Women Judges and the Rule of Law, Assessing the Past and Anticipating the Future. The keynote speaker was U.S. Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, whose message to the women judges was that judicial leadership is critical to human rights advancement, and equal justice is the glue of stability. I could not have said it any better, and it is a perfect starting point for today's presentation. Now, my comments are intended to be relevant to all nations, but I will focus some specifics to Caribbean countries. A core legal principle in the law of civilized nations is that everyone must be treated equally, without special privileges, discrimination, or bias. A review of the historical dialogue concerning the inclusion or exclusion of individuals based on identifiers such as race, gender, and sexual orientation reveals the integral part the justice system has played in undermining equal treatment of women, children, and LGBTI persons on the many nations' laws. A brief review of the 2015 human rights reports for each Caribbean nation exemplifies the dilemma these countries face in implementing this core legal principle. Access to justice involves the justice system efficiently delivering fair and accessible outcomes to all, regardless of wealth and status. It is a system where an individual's rights are protected through a process that is neutral and without discrimination. It involves promoting accessibility by removing and eliminating barriers, and it requires a review of and fundamental changes to our justice system to ensure true access to justice for all who appears before our courts. When I speak of the justice system, I am referring to three agencies that operate together under the rule of law within a society, and they should operate free from arbitrary decisions of individual government officials. The first is the legislative agency that creates the laws. Second is the courts that adjudicate the laws. And third is the law enforcement agency that enforces the laws. The aim of the justice system should be to promote public confidence that the system is fair with equity, fairness, and protection of individual rights as its goals. Unfortunately, the three agencies of the justice system frequently impede access to justice for its citizens, and that is also true for a majority of the Caribbean countries. According to the 2015 human rights reports, the problems these countries face regarding gender and sexual orientation cover five main areas. They are consensual sexual activity, rape, sexual harassment, domestic violence, and children. Now, justice is culturally defined by the moral concept of the society within which it is viewed. And both morality and judicial teachings are based on principles of equality, equity, ethics, religion, and the like. Therefore, a review of the culture of a country is helpful and necessary in understanding the challenges it faces in providing access to justice. In many of the Caribbean countries, adult consensual same-sex sexual activity between men is criminalized with penalties ranging from 2 years to life imprisonment. Barbados and some islands specifically criminalize anal intercourse. In fact, anal intercourse in Guyana appears to be punishable with a maximum sentence of life in prison, regardless of whether the persons are of the same sex. Many of the islands explicitly do not prohibit sexual activity between women. And all of the countries have little or no legal prohibition against gender identity or sexual orientation discrimination. Trinidad and Tobago also has immigration laws that bar the entry of homosexuals into the country. And even though many of the islands report no enforcement of their anti-LGBTI laws, some, like Jamaica, utilize the laws to intimidate gay men or men perceived to be gay. Jamaica reports that its laws are only enforced in cases of sexual assault and child molestation and are not used to prosecute consensual same-sex sexual conduct between men. However, I must note that there are reported cases of murders of people perceived to be LGBTI persons, which makes the data reported questionable. In many of the islands, rape, including spousal rape, is illegal and punishment varies from 10 years up to life imprisonment. Jamaica criminalizes spousal rape only under specific conditions, such as separation or during dissolution proceedings. In 2015 in St. Lucia, a criminal activity called rouchement, where parents of young rape victims choose to settle cases out of the court rather than pursuing prosecution, receive public scrutiny. This criminal activity is reported, rarely prosecuted. And one reason given for the parents' behavior is that the high unemployment rate among female heads of households has created an incentive for these women to accept payouts. One government official aptly acknowledged that this was a clear failure of the justice system, as the law has a responsibility to protect children. Many of the Caribbean countries have no laws that specifically prohibit sexual harassment, and limited legal remedies exist for victims of sexual harassment. Now, Guyana does have a law that prohibits sexual harassment, and it provides monetary penalties and awards of damages to victims. But in August of 2015, three law enforcement officers were dismissed for becoming pregnant. Turns out there was a rule within the police department prohibiting female constables from becoming pregnant within the first 2 years of their employment. Public outcry forced the government to acknowledge that the policy was discriminatory, and the officers were reinstated. However, in many of the islands, many incidents of sexual harassment do go unreported. Similarly, domestic violence for the Caribbean nations continues to be a significant problem. Many of the islands prosecute crimes of violence against women only when the victim pressed charges. This requirement impedes access to justice, as victims are reluctant to press charges due to their financial dependence on the abuser. Confidence is lacking, as there is no confidentiality in the process. The police are usually part of the problem, and there's a general lack of confidence that a real remedy can be obtained through the courts, as sentences are short and support systems for the victims are inadequate. Many Caribbean countries have an inadequate legal framework for the protection of children, and young school-age children are vulnerable to rape and physical abuse. In 2012, Trinidad and Tobago's Children Act decriminalized sexual exploration between minors close in age, but then specifically retained language criminalizing the same activity among same-sex minors. In many of the countries, the legal age for marriage is 18, and underage marriage can be allowed with parental consent. Currently, Trinidad and Tobago is debating its marriage laws. The legal age for civil and Christian marriage is 18. However, distinct laws and various religious denominations determine the legal age for marriage. For example, the minimum legal age under the Muslim Marriage and Divorce Act is 16 for males and 12 for females. Under the Hindu Marriage Act, it is 18 for males and 14 for females. And under the Orissa Marriage Act, it is 18 for males and 16 for females. Many of the countries have laws that define a child as less than 18 years of age, with the age of sexual consent ranging from 16 to 18 years. Penalties for various forms of sexual contact with a minor vary up to a maximum of life imprisonment. St. Lucia has a defense of consent if a victim is between 12 and 16. In St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the law does not specifically prohibit child pornography. All of the islands have an underreporting of gender, sexual orientation, and child abuse crimes. There is reluctance of individuals to report incidents of violence or abuse due to fear of stigma, fear of retribution, or reprisal. There is also a lack of confidence in authorities because of harassment from or perceived insensitivity of law enforcement and the courts. And there's cultural acceptance of gender and sexual orientation based violence. Police often hesitate or are reluctant to enforce domestic violence laws, and perpetrators of rape and sexual abuse against women and children enjoy impunity. Since the concept of justice differs in every culture, access to justice for Caribbean women, children, and LGBTI persons requires not just equality before the law, but also equal opportunity. Two concepts used interchangeably, but are not synonymous. Equality before the law stands for the proposition that all are equal before the law and are entitled without any discrimination to equal protection of the law. Whereas equal opportunity requires that all people be treated similarly without prejudice or unjust barriers. Many of the Caribbean countries have achieved what I call formal equality, but not substantive equality. In fact, the concept of equality for all has created a moral construct dilemma. It has created restrictions based on arbitrary characteristics such as gender and sexual orientation, which has allowed nefarious decision making based on those same identifiers. This must be replaced by equitable, just, and fair application of the law. There are extensive problems affecting all three parts of the justice system, and as a result, a comprehensive directive is needed to solve the problem. A collaborative strategy that combines efforts and limited resources to achieve just results is one way the courts can deal with the challenges to social sustainability based on gender and LGBTI cases. Another is an inclusive approach that recognizes the crucial role of building partnerships with others in order to achieve gender equality and equality for LGBTI persons. For example, one judge said, "Not all women are feminists, but a lot of men are feminists." Keep in mind, judges do not make laws, legislators do. Judges should interpret the laws irrespective of their personal beliefs and moral convictions. And judges have the authority to make decisions that foster access to justice for all that appear in the courts. It is imperative that we recognize the many faces of discrimination because the effect is the same. There is minimal difference between gender-based discrimination and LGBTI discrimination. Stigma is discrimination. Stereotypes and prejudices are discriminations. And violence is just another form of discrimination used against both groups. In both situations, intolerance is used as a justification for perpetrating discrimination. These groups experience discrimination based on what can be termed the optional conduct argument. That is, that your status may not be changeable, but your conduct is a personal choice. An access to justice approach is one way the justice system can deal with the many challenges it faces in dealing with gender and sexual orientation cases. A civilized nation ensures fairness by delivering real remedies for its problems. An access to justice approach requires a comprehensive overhaul of the justice system with concrete goals for the new infrastructure that will be created. It requires institutional changes within law enforcement agencies with clear directives and real consequences. Transparency in all procedures, specifically the investigation of crimes against women, children, or LGBTI individuals. And proper documentation and real and effective follow-through are required. Justice Ginsburg also said that the law was already gender sensitive to one gender, men. And women judges can bring gender sensitivity to tackling these major injustices. As judges, we have a responsibility to educate, as access to justice requires elimination of attitudes, norms, beliefs, and practices that perpetuate discrimination based on gender and sexual orientation, and which reinforces tolerance for all forms of violence against women, children, and LGBTI persons. The justice system must create safe spaces for dialogue, as this will empower women, children, and LGBTI persons to become visible and tell their stories. Dialogue regarding discrimination that is based on sex or gender should include sexual orientation. The importance of a more inclusive approach cannot be underestimated, as a gender equal society must be inclusive of all women, to include lesbians, bisexual, and most importantly, transgender women. I often think of how useful a resource we have failed to utilize, as transgender women have a unique perspective on discrimination. After all, they have seen the world from a male's point of view. Fear has dictated the approach taken to address the intersectionality of these issues. And in addition to education and awareness, a review of the assorted gender and sexual orientation laws of the Caribbean countries are necessary, as presently they sanction discrimination. Some of the laws even presume sexual relationships between individuals with little more than gossip, innuendo, and insinuation. Even though the governments loudly proclaim that the laws are not enforced or are only enforced in specific circumstances, there are many examples of governmental, police, and judicial actions or decisions based on these suppositions. To ensure social sustainability, each country needs statutory and policy changes that support development of legal protections for all. The aim should be to eliminate discrimination embedded in the present laws and policies. This can be done by creating legal and institutional frameworks that embrace protecting rights to justice, social, and economic systems. However, this approach does require transparency and accountability. Finally, the problems of gender and sexual orientation are intertwined, and so are the solutions. If we as a society are asking women, children, and LGBTI persons to become visible, we must provide them with meaningful access to the courts. There must be more collaboration within the justice system, because if people don't have meaningful access to the courts cannot protect them. But there also must be collaboration amongst the various non-governmental organizations that must see that their struggles are won and their strength in numbers. To the members of the judiciary, remember the words of Justice Ginsburg. Judicial leadership is critical to human rights advancement, as equal justice is the glue of stability. We have an obligation to see that all individuals that come before our courts are treated fairly, impartially, and without any bias, to include discrimination. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for quite comprehensive presentation. Quite a lot of useful solutions and hints that were given there. At this point in time, we're going to give the audience an opportunity to ask your questions. I see that we've already received some questions, so we're going to go right into answering these. Okay. And of course, if you have any technical difficulties, please refresh your page and the webinar should be loaded and you can submit your questions. So the first question, ongoing training of members of the judicial system, including lawyers, judges, etc., is essential. How can this be incorporated in the existing judicial training mechanisms?
This is where I believe the judiciary has to take a role in establishing a curriculum that addresses these issues as I've listed and make it part of the curriculum for our lawyers, for our judiciary, and for the public at large. I believe in a collaboration effort. So we have individuals in the education system, professors, teachers, who can then connect with the NGO establishment. Those individuals have on the ground information. And then you have individuals such as myself and lawyers who bring the legal perspective, be inclusive of law enforcement as they have to enforce the laws and they appear to be a big problem in many of the Caribbean islands. Bring these pieces together to create a curriculum that is imparted and becomes part of the education process for the individuals in the legal community as well as others.
Okay, thank you very much. And we have another question. It says, what would it take to get these laws off the book? And can a private citizen, for that matter, an expat, bring a lawsuit against a country?
Okay. Couple of things there. In regards to the second question as to whether or not a private citizen can bring a lawsuit against a country, I believe each country would have its own laws and procedures as to how that can be done, if it can be done, because it can be very much a country-specific or a nation-specific legal question. In regards to what one can do in regards to changing the laws, it is very difficult to change the laws, and you need a momentum of some sort. Which is why I also believe that educating and making people more aware of women's issues, LGBTI issues, issues that affect these particular groups, how these laws impact these various groups, as well as individuals that don't belong to these groups. As I've indicated, one of the laws in regards to anal intercourse, and I believe it's Guyana, actually affects individuals who are not homosexual. It affects heterosexual individuals. So before you get people to change their laws, and there will always be a fight back in regards to doing so, it is easier to work on changing people's minds through education and making them aware. Fear is a big factor that's running through a lot of the Caribbean nations. Fear and incorrect education being put out there as to these different groups. And that is feeding the discrimination, the stigma, the stereotypes that these groups are facing. I do believe being visible is helpful. However, I am very cognizant of the fact when you ask people to be visible, you have to be able to protect them. Why then should they come out? You know, it's blaming the victim kind of mentality. Why would a battered woman report that she's being battered when there are no support networks in place or adequate support systems in place to protect her? She comes before the court, the individual gets minimal time, if at any at all. She goes to law enforcement, you know, it's not high priority. We are letting our citizens down, we, the justice system. And so hopefully in answering your question, it takes awareness. Changing the laws is very difficult to do, but it can be done, and it will be done, I'm quite sure, but it's going to be a slow process.
Okay. All right, thank you very much. And then moving right along. How can domestic workers, this is from Trinidad and Tobago, how can domestic workers get justice in TNT when they are not recognized as a worker under the Industrial Relations Act? Even though the CEDAW has made that recommendation to our government, the situation remains the same.
And that's where, more than likely, in order to address that question, we're talking again about collaborative efforts. The issue that was just raised by that question indicates to me that some of the NGO organizations in Trinidad and Tobago are not seeing the intersectionality of the issues that they are facing. You cannot discriminate against one group and then hold yourself up as not being discriminatory in another. You cannot have policies in place that protect one group and doesn't protect others. So in order to address that individual's question as far as domestic workers, I do believe a collaborative effort with some of the NGOs in Trinidad and Tobago can assist in addressing that disparity in treatment.
Great, thank you. And then, so you spoke about meaningful access to the courts as fundamental for the achievement of gender equality. You also stated that without access to the courts, individuals cannot be protected. In the Dutch Caribbean, meaningful access is hindered by language. How would you speak to the importance of language in accessing the courts specifically and the law in general?
Language is key because the law itself is words. And you have to communicate, which is by way of education, you have to communicate and make people aware of deficiencies within the system. Language is huge. Even here in the United States, we are dealing with a language issue. And what the courts here have done in Washington State is actually started a process of creating what we call plain language forms and documents. I can speak from a judicial perspective, from an intellectual perspective, and many of the individuals that come before me can't understand what I'm saying, cannot comprehend how it impacts them. So similarly, I believe in regards to the Dutch language issue, taking the issues and breaking it down to plain language may be one means of addressing that issue or that problem that that particular country is facing. You have to look at the laws and you have to make them accessible. In making them accessible, you have to make it the language plain enough that all can interpret and understand what is being done.
Okay, thank you very much. And another question, concerning the current discussion in Trinidad and Tobago on the age of consent for marriage, to what extent is this a cultural and or a national legal issue?
I think it's both. First of all, it's a cultural issue because as I prepared this presentation, growing up in Trinidad and Tobago, because I left at the age of 16, I was aware of marriages of young individuals from different religious groups. I honestly cannot tell you that I was aware that there were at least three or four different marriage acts that were based in religion. I just thought they were religious teachings, but I did not realize there were actually legal acts in place. The question I have is, why do we need different marriage acts to protect children? And my review of the law indicates that it's actually the females, because the age of consent in one aspect of the laws indicates 16, yet some of the marriage acts in Trinidad and Tobago allow marriage as young as 12. We are not protecting our children. In regards to whether or not this is an international problem, of course it is. It is an international legal problem. It's an international human rights problem. Because children that age cannot consent. However, we have to be cognizant of the cultural issues facing certain groups under these marriage acts because it's religion. It's based on their religion convictions and beliefs. And we have to take into account that. So I would have to say that the religious leaders of these religious organizations need to honestly look at what is the import of having marriages of a 12-year-old. What is the aim of that? And why is that still on the books? And why is it relevant to your religion and your religious conviction? What benefit does it give your religious teachings? Because I really believe if they look at it, they will realize there is none. At the time that these laws were put in place, these marriage acts were put in place, their religious teachings evolved, maybe. But the world has evolved from that. We see these young individuals as children that need protection, and the whole idea of giving them adult responsibilities with an adult male is reprehensible and needs to be changed.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think we have some time for some more questions. So another question, with regard to the acronym LGBT, I was wondering if LGBTIQ is now the official and correct term to use, and exactly what do the letters I and Q refer to? Thank you so much, Judge.
Hello? I would assume that you're still hearing me because I'm not. Kadeem? Oh dear. All right, I will continue and assume that you're hearing me. Okay, can you hear me?
Just had some minor.
All right.
Technical difficulties.
All right.
But we're back on.
Thank you. The LGBTI. So,
yeah.
Okay, so lesbian, bisexual, transgender, gay, bisexual, transgender, and intersex. That's the meaning of the I believe, to the individual's question. And what is the correct way to refer to someone? My response as a judicial officer is you ask the individual how they would like to be addressed. For example, we have transgender individuals that come before the court. You ask the individual how they want to be addressed, whether they want the pronoun he or she, whether they, you know, it depends on the situation. So instead of presuming you know, I believe the best course of action is to ask. And by doing so, oddly enough, the individual feels rather comfortable and the discourse is a little more relaxed and more open and accepting.
Great, thank you. And another question, how can gender and sexual minorities best organize in environments of gross structural violence without depending on an allyship that can very often be itself transactional and exploitative on both an interpersonal and group level?
Could you repeat that again, please?
How can gender and sexual minorities best organize, I'm guessing, come together in environments of structural violence without depending on an allyship that can very often be itself transactional and exploitative on both an interpersonal and group level?
That's a difficult one because it's the evolution path of just about every marginalized group. It's the question that every marginalized group, I believe, has had to address at some point in time. Because many times you start off with one, and how do you address discrimination, prejudices, stigma when you're small? And that creates a difficulty there because many of the Caribbean islands are in that exact same position, which is why my take on that situation is we have to create partnerships. We cannot do it alone. You may think you are alone, but there's a risk to be invisible because the negativity that's coming towards us is so severe. But some visibility is required. Reaching out and opening up when you feel it's safe to do so is one means of starting the process. You have many allies today, which is a lot better than it was back in many years ago. But you have many allies today in different parts of the economic structure, societal structure, that can be assistance. The difficulty, I think, is finding these individuals. And that's where we have to do a better job of getting that information out, especially to outlying areas, individuals who are not connected. But that is a very important question and a very difficult dilemma. Just about every country, to include the United States, has on some level. You have to become a little visible. You have to take a chance. But I say if you do so, be safe with it.
Great. Thank you. Another question. Coverage of cases by the media can translate into inflammatory, sensational headlines. They also sometimes blame the victim and report cases of sexual violence and rape as sex between the victim and perpetrator. They suggest unfairly that the victim consented in the act before the courts. What mechanisms are there to have the media report more accurately on sexual violence and rape cases?
Okay, we're back to educating. Unfortunately, we have a number of uneducated individuals in positions of authority. Unfortunately, I feel sad that I have to say that, but it is so true. In that, we look up to these individuals, they speak from a position of authority, and yet they are speaking about things they know nothing about. We have to change the communication mechanism, the dialogue, the terminologies used, the concepts behind some of these issues. I just gave you one, blaming the victim. How can you refer, for example, how can you be upset with a woman who has been abused and then she's required to file charges? Are we missing a core premise here? She is abused and she has been abused by her abuser, and now she's being abused by the system. She's being asked to come forward without any support mechanism whatsoever in place. Education is key. But back to the question regarding the media and their disclosure of inaccurate information. We live in an age of social media. And thank goodness we do. We need to utilize these forums to get educated discourse out to the community. Many individuals are using these mediums. The print media is still very popular in a lot of the Caribbean countries. However, you will see that a younger generation is moving more towards social media because it's more encompassing of worldviews. So we need to control the dialogue. We need to control the language used to define the situations that are being used to define us. A person who has been raped means non-consensual. So you cannot have consensual rape. So therefore, that individual is a victim. And the right terminology is a victim. Stop blaming the victim for the actions of his or her abuser. So we need to control the dialogue. We need to do a better job of educating the uneducated, authoritative figures that we have. And we also need to understand, each one of us, that this is a learning curve. I don't know everything. You don't know everything. But I bet I can learn a lot from you, and you can learn a lot from me. And that is the purpose behind these forums and the discourse. We both get something from it, and we need to take that information and take it out beyond this webinar, beyond this discussion. We need to put action behind the words.
Thank you. And I think we have time for a couple more questions. So as we address the issue of child marriage, we have to be careful when it comes to raising the age of sexual consent, as this can and will have implications for access to sexual and reproductive health. Is there a way to keep the two separate? Minors should not be forced to marry, but minors engaging in sexual activity should have access to SRH without parental consent.
I missed part of that question, so could you just repeat it, please?
No problem. As we address the issue of child marriage, we have to be careful when it comes to raising the age of sexual consent, as this can and will have implications for access to sexual and reproductive health. Is there a way to keep the two separate? Minors should not be forced to marry, but minors engaging in sexual activity should have access to SRH, sexual and reproductive health, without parental consent.
That's a very, very insightful question. I believe we need to see them as intertwined yet with distinct differences. The Marriage Act deals with the age of allowing a minor female, it appears most of the minors in that situation are the females, to marry adult males. The issue there is not just sexual. The sexual interaction is a very big part of it, because that goes along with marriage under a number of these religious tenets. The issue there is a child being given adult responsibilities, sex being one of those responsibilities. But there are many other responsibilities adult women in marriage take on that a child should not. In regards to the sexual consent, raising the age of sexual consent, that's different as far as my review of it, in that that is a legal requirement for our courts to avoid children from taking part in adult sexual activity that has the repercussions, as you're indicating, of reproductive health issues. Can we keep them separate? We'll have to, until we have some consensus in regards to the legal age of consent. We also need to work on the reproductive health legislation or policies, in that there should be some, I'm trying to figure out the right, there should be some ability of individuals, minors, who engage in sexual activity receiving reproductive, sexual reproductive education, and help from agencies in certain circumstances. I am a little leery in regards to a blanket without the approval of the parent, because again, it flies in the face of these are minors, they need protection, and a parent's role is paramount in raising their children. But I believe it should be accessible to them in some form or another. But I haven't really given a whole lot of thought to that aspect of the argument, but it is a very insightful question, I must say the least. I can't hear you.
In Trinidad and Tobago, same-sex partners can adopt. What are your views on adoption by same-sex partners and the idea being advanced that this interferes with the adoptive child's right to family life under the Convention on the Rights of the Child? As we have seen, such children elsewhere challenge their adoption when they become adults.
Repeat it since we had a breakout at the beginning, please.
In TNT, same-sex partners cannot adopt. What are your views on adoption by same-sex partners and the idea being advanced that this interferes with the adoptive child's right to family life under the Convention on the Rights of the Child? As we have seen, such children elsewhere challenge their adoption when they become adults.
I don't see a difference between same-sex couples adopting children and heterosexual couples adopting children. And oddly enough, I don't see that based on my upbringing in Trinidad and Tobago, a country where the family structure and the definition of a family varied immensely. I am familiar with heterosexual couples raising children like my parents did. I am familiar with heads of household being male without a female raising children. I am familiar with women being heads of household with no men raising children, extended family, aunts, uncles raising children, grandparents raising children, to include strangers raising other people's children. So when it comes to same-sex adoption, there should not be a difference. The important thing is the individual, or can the individuals provide a loving and safe environment for the children involved? I have a hard time conceptualizing same-sex couples not having or not being able to raise children because of the fact that the relationship they're in happens to be two individuals of the same gender. Because that is something I've seen growing up, and the two individuals happen to be of the same sex, but were not sexually active or sexually involved. There are many instances where you have a grandmother in the same home with an aunt and a mother raising everybody's children that belongs to that family. So I think it's a false premise, and it's a discriminatory setup to promote an agenda that is flies in the face of equal rights, as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you very much. And for our final question, what do you think, in your opinion, Trinidad and Tobago, and by extension, the Caribbean, can realistically achieve for LGBTI rights in the next 10 years?
In the next 10 years, I anticipate being able to return to Trinidad and Tobago before then, but in the next 10 years, mm-hmm. with the immigration laws not being on the books, I anticipate being able to come to Trinidad and Tobago and receive more of an inclusive environment for all, but more specifically, movements that recognizes women as equals in its true sense, that sees us as equal and provides us with the opportunity to be connected to our community. I see women as being the leaders moving the agenda of equal rights for all and equity and equal opportunity for all forward. Our countries have been male dominated. I believe one of the fears is women being becoming powerful, and it is happening. We are no longer just being quiet, we are visible. When you see students get up and leave their classrooms because they are not happy with what they're seeing being portrayed in the media or in the newspaper in regards to discriminatory treatment, when you see the outcry in regards to a teacher berating a student because of a perceived sexual orientation, when you see women standing up in regards to rape allegations and the derogatory dialogue that goes with that, I see a future for Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean Islands that's bright. And I anticipate being a part of that, even though I am here in the US. And that's my vision in the next 10 years, and I see it happening.
Okay, thank you so much, Judge Whitener. Unfortunately, due to time constraints, that would be it for the questions. Thank you very much for sharing. Thank you very much for answering our questions, Judge Whitener. And of course, I'm sure that everyone would agree there's quite a lot of food for thought that was given in this webinar, and the exchange was very valuable. Thank you, of course, to our online viewers for joining us and asking your questions, for sharing your comments. They were all very, very useful. Judge Whitener, I'm not sure if you'd like to say anything in closing.
Thank you all for attending the webinar. I am open to learning. I am open to educating. It's part of my mantra. So therefore, if you can think of anything that would assist me in understanding the problems that my countries are facing, my Caribbean nations, I may be a transplant in the United States. I do my work here, but I can't where I came from. But for my upbringing, I would not be where I am today. So I thank you all for the support that you've provided me. And I have a voice. I intend to continue to use it. Thank you.
Thank you very much again. And of course, thank you to the Caribbean Future Forum's partners, for all of you who continue to join our discussions and contribute to them. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at @forum_Caribbean. Visit the website, CaribbeanFutureForum.com. This webinar will be available in 3 days online. And you can, of course, share it with your partners. Anyone who may have missed some of the webinar, you can review it then. And do have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you.